Hello, I am Dr. Vijay Rao. I am a rheumatologist working in Manipal Hospital, Bangalore. Today I will talk to you on a rare autoimmune disorder called scleroderma. By definition, sclero means thickening or hard and derma means skin. So scleroderma means hard skin. So that is the basic concept of the disease. It's usually a disease seen more common in females between the age of 15 to 45 years. And it is not very common, but it is not very rare as well. At the start I said it's an autoimmune disease. By that I mean that the immune system falsely recognizes our tissues as foreign, especially the skin, and attacks it. So, there are different types of scleroderma. Commonly, we can divide that into localized and systemic. And in localized, we have something called morphea, which is evolving or involving one part of the skin of the body. Or you can have a linear scleroderma where it involves in a line or a strip of thickening of skin. When it affects the internal part of the body, we call it as systemic scleroderma, in which you have two variants, limited and diffuse. And what causes this damage in the skin? There are three mechanisms of damage. First is inflammation or autoimmunity. Autoimmunity, as I said, is immune system attacking our own skin, and it's consequence of inflammation, where a lot of chemicals are produced causing damage of the skin and the internal organs. And due to the inflammation, the resulting part is called scarring or fibrosis, which involves the skin, internal organs such as lung and heart. There's also scarring of the blood vessels. We call that vascular injury, and that can involve the fingers, all causing things like Raynaud's phenomenon, where the fingers go cold, change colors to pale and blue color, especially in cold weather. And if it is not controlled, in extreme stages it can lead to what we call as dry gangrene or death of the tissues. It can also affect blood vessels in the internal organs, mainly the lung blood vessels. So the three components are inflammation due to autoimmunity, vascular injury or Raynaud's phenomenon, and fibrosis, which is a consequence of inflammation. So at the start I told in systemic involvement, there are two varieties, limited and diffuse. In the limited, what you are seeing in the white part is paired. So the grey part, which is the both elbows, the face and up to the knees, are involved. But in the diffuse, you see the whole body is involved. The other features distinguishing between diffuse and limited is diffuse quickly evolves over a span of few months, affecting the whole body. And internal organs such as lung, heart and kidney are more involved in the diffuse variety. So, to put it in simple terms, diffuse means severe disease affecting the person or the patient in a quicker way and a rapid way. And it can lead to a lot of disability and fatigue and aches and pains. In limited variety, it involves Raynaud's or skin circulation problems at a very early stage in life, and then causing skin thickening, which is affecting only up to the elbows or knees for several years before it spreads to other parts of the body. And with limited heart and kidney involvement. And usually you see pulmonary hypertension as a feature in the limited fashion. This graph, you see the blue line is the diffuse variant, the pink line is the limited variant. The diffuse is the severe disease, the pink is the milder disease. So if you see in the pinker one, the pink one, the skin thickening is what is shown on this side, and this side shows the disease duration in years. So it gradually involves the skin and sort of plateaus over several years. Even at 20 years of the disease, it's not involved the skin to a greater extent. And you see certain variants at the about 15 years or so causing pulmonary hypertension and absorption problems in the intestine. Whereas in diffuse disease, it involves the skin at a very early stage, even before second year or first year. It's caused a lot of, more than 50% of skin thickening and affecting internal organs like intestines, lungs, heart and kidneys at a very early stage. And after that, it sort of plateaus. So this gives you an idea that in a diffuse disease, it affects the body in a very rapid form. This slide shows that on here, you can see a normal skin fold when you pinch it. But in scleroderma, you are not able to get the pinch, the skin fold, that is due to the skin thickening. And this is more like proximal scleroderma. This is a classical scleroderma appearance called salt and pepper appearance, involving hypopigmentation patches. Very, very classical of scleroderma. This is typically called microstomia, where involves the skin around the mouth or puckering, where unable to open the mouth and have difficulty in eating or even speaking. And you have something called as telangiectasias around the lips, red lesions, which are abnormal blood flow or capillaries caused by this disease. These are the hand deformities you see in scleroderma, where you see something called calcium deposits called calcinosis. Then you see digital ulcers due to lack of circulation, and if you don't take care, the fingers fall off, causing autoamputation. Then in the early phase stage of the disease, you see puffy fingers with a lot of inflammation. And the Raynaud's, which I showed, is classical color changes causing pale color and blue color changes, and here you see a nice digital ulcer which is causing on the fingers due to lack of circulation. This is an extreme stage of scleroderma. You see almost hard tethery skin, hardly you can see any sort of muscle tissue there, and a lot of deformities are there, shiny appearing hardened skin, and with lot of ulcers on the tips. Really, this is an end stage of the disease, which we should not be seeing if treatment is started early. In the intestines, it can affect from the food pipe at the top till the colon or the rectum till the end. The food pipe, it causes lack of peristalsis movement. When we eat, the food doesn't drop down to the stomach directly. It gradually involves movement through the muscles involved in the food pipe. In scleroderma, the peristalsis is lost, hence the food gets stuck in the food pipe. You can also have in scleroderma, due to lack of the gate controlling the food and the food pipe and the gastric mucosa, the acid directly enters the food pipe and causing severe ulcers and narrowing called stricture. That again can accumulate food in the food pipe, causing delayed gastric emptying problems. Coming further down in the intestine, small intestine, food gets accumulated here, causing dilated loops. The food gradually goes down the jejunum due to lack of musculature of the jejunum. And in the colon, you can see something called as dilated loops or pseudo diverticula, where all bacteria sit here, causing what we call as bacterial overgrowth syndrome and malabsorption problems. So in effect, scleroderma patients have a lot of gastric irritation, food gets stuck, digestion is a problem, and so the entire part of the gastrointestinal system is involved. You can see here on endoscopy a very rare manifestation in the food pipe of the esophagus and the stomach, causing GAVE, gastric antral vascular ectasia, where the blood vessels are abnormally dilated. This sometimes can bleed and cause severe anemia and weakness and dizziness and palpitations. other major manifestation of scleroderma is lung. Patients do die of scleroderma due to lung problems. So a simple chest x-ray will be unable to pick up lung issues in scleroderma, and what we need is a high resolution CT scan or HRCT scan. So on this side of the CT you see a lot of white findings, which are nothing but scarring and inflammation of the lungs. This you see both in the diffuse and the limited variant. On this side you see a lot of white structures here, which are nothing but dilated blood vessels or pulmonary hypertension, which is seen mainly in the limited scleroderma. The difference between both is, in the pulmonary hypertension, when you patients don't have much of cough, and in the CT scan you don't see inflammation, but you see dilated pulmonary blood vessels, which can cause gas exchange problems, which I'll talk about later, causing severe breathing difficulties, and when the oxygen levels are low, it causes severe fatigue. Whereas opposed to in a lung disease, where the scarring is due to the inflammation, where this fluid gets accumulated, and that also causes abnormal blood vessel problems in the lungs, and the net effect is reduced oxygenation, which is bad for the patients. So if you see this diagram, this is the right side of the heart and this is the left side of the heart. Impure blood, which is blue in color, goes to the lungs, which is all these balloons, and the pure and it gets oxygenated, where oxygen taken from our nose gets into the blood, carbon dioxide gets exchanged and goes outside our nose, and the pure blood comes back to the left side of the heart. In scleroderma, due to the problems I told, which is the lung disease or the pulmonary pressure problems, the oxygenation is impaired. When the oxygenation is impaired, blood gets pooled on this side of the heart, causing pulmonary pressures to increase. And in late stages, the left side of the heart is also affected, causing pumping capacity of the heart will be affected, and that leads to severe blood pressure problems, circulation problems, and slowly the heart functions will deteriorate. So the main issue is actually in the oxygenation part, due to either the lung disease or blood vessel problem, which is affecting the pulmonary arteries, which carries the impure blood from the right side to the lungs to get purified, and then that goes to the right left side of the heart. So here this picture is showing the narrowing of the pulmonary arteries, which I was talking about the last time. So here in this you see blood vessels which are on the normal side in the lungs going up to the peripheries, but in a scleroderma patient the blood vessels in the initial part of the lungs are enlarged, and in the end almost the blood vessels are virtually absent. So this is the main cause of death in scleroderma patients. Diagnosis in scleroderma is mostly clinical. As I've told you, listed you following features affecting the skin, affecting the lung, the heart, the joints, and some antibody tests called ANA tests. Not everybody in scleroderma will have ANA. Mostly patients will have ANA positivity, but even if ANA negative patients are there, but skin is predominantly affected, circulation is affected, internal organs are affected, you can still have scleroderma if your ANA tests are normal. And there's a particular antibody called SCL70 antibody, which usually is seen in diffuse scleroderma patients or the rapid version of scleroderma patients. The presence of antibody shows that the disease can be high and needs to be treated aggressively. This is a slide which shows that if you have swollen fingers, circulation problems in the fingers, and heartburn, you need to contact a rheumatologist early so that you are diagnosed and appropriately treated. This disease, if treated early, you know, through appropriate medications which control the immune system, can help the skin problems, can help the lung problems, can help the kidney and the heart problems. And also for circulation, we give tablets which controls the blood vessels and reduces the blood vessel pressure. and helps the lungs and the skin also. Appropriate diagnosis is very, very important, and hence, to summarize again, swollen fingers, circulation problems, heart burn or gastric issues, please contact a rheumatologist early on. Thank you very much. I hope you have benefited from this video. At the end of the day, it's a treatable disease, nothing to worry. Positive outlook in life is very, very important, and a lot of patients lead a normal life with successful treatment. Thank you very much.